Probably one important question is that the pro-Israeli policy in our security considerations is important. And I think that is also a common Central European approach, which is important to maintain.
Andrzej Sendecki, Specialist in Wschodnich, Center for Eastern Studies here in Warsaw. Here in Warsaw, actually, we will have next year in July the NATO summit. So, my question is, what could be the Hungarian input, in your opinion, for instance, regarding the strengthening of the Eastern Flank? That is the first question. And the second question is about the Central European cooperation that you were speaking a lot. And I think that the Hungarian government was quite active in this sphere in the last couple of years. The question is, to what extent the neighboring relations of Hungary can be an obstacle? Well, what we see now is the very complicated relationship with Romania for the last 3-4 years already. Now with the migrant crisis, the deteriorating relationship with Croatia, to some extent Serbia and Austria. So the question is, to what extent the Hungarian government is trying to improve these relations? And can we expect that, for example, regarding Romania, we could see a similar scenario as with Slovakia, that you have several problems regarding the minority, but somehow you are able to develop a pragmatic cooperation. Thank you.
Thank you very much. NATO summit. I think it is a very unique opportunity for us, the NATO summit in Warsaw, to take on agenda the most sensitive problems of Central Europe and in our cooperation. NATO is back, and I think it is a very positive outcome of the Ukraine-Russia war, that NATO got back its speed, identity, and mission. And I think the Wales decisions are extremely encouraging. And you have now to continue these main lines decided there. For our region, there are many clear tasks. The NATO response force and the headquarters settled and brought into the region, giving a clear obligation to the member states to increase their defense budget. And Hungary has decided that we double our defense budget, and that was announced last year after, actually at the NATO summit, Viktor Orban announced that. So, and I can see that you, the new government, peace, has decided to increase even more, from 2-3%, your defense expenditure, which is impressive. I hope you can do that. So, and we should rally and discuss how we can cooperate in this field. For example, to consider a kind of defense cooperation in Central Europe between Poland and Hungary would be something which I think worth attention and consideration. For us, it's always very important our neighborhood, eastern and southeastern neighborhood. And for that very reason, the NATO summit in Warsaw could be a summit of enlargement. The open door policy of NATO for two NATO summits was just lip service. But nothing happened. I hope that Montenegro, Crna Gora, can enter in Warsaw. I don't see any obstacle, and has started to speak about that. So the Hungarian communities in the neighboring countries is a kind of factual precondition for the Hungarian regional policy. And it is not just a problem, but it is also an advantage. We have these millions of people who speak two languages, who are mediating, who have economic and cultural activities. I would draw your attention that they have been very strong stabilizing factors in these countries. The Romanian Hungarian community was in the forefront of the Western integration of Romania in the past 25 years. And they have got continuous presence in the forefront of the Romanian government and parliamentary activities. The Hungarian community in Slovakia is 12%, and their political role has been very similar. When Mečiar was brought down, the expertise and the professionalism of the Hungarian party was very crucial in the success of the Zurinda cabinet to re-enter the European path. So the Hungarians in these societies are part of the solution, I'm convinced. And this is how we look at them. That's what we would like all political forces to recognize. Unfortunately, nationalism in the region is not unknown, and especially since 2012, the nationalism of the left, which is pretty interesting, of the Romanian left, is very vivid. We had a smooth cooperation with Mr. Basescu and the parties of Mr. Basescu. He had many parties. Unfortunately, since 2012, Mr. Ponta has been constantly rallying around this nationalist card. Now there is a cohabitation. Mr. Ioannis is elected from the opposition, a kind of similar situation to you. There is an election period, and in Croatia also there is an election period. And we believe that these elections may create favorable conditions for regional cooperation, but it will not depend on us. We will be open and ready for that. As I told you, we are very much interested in a close and flourishing regional cooperation. Behind the Central European idea, for us, this is a strong motivation. And I'm sure that the Polish contribution can be, if you support the Central European integration, and you do, I hope, this is a fact now, you can be a good broker in this process, and we are glad to accept if you can be helpful in that regard.
Okay. Well, it's not a question, it's maybe a kind of remark or just an explanation. I don't expect you to answer. I had a honor to cooperate with Mr. Naimski on diversification of oil and gas 8 years ago. And I was involved also in some infrastructure projects with Hungary. But of course, the government was different. It was Georgiani. Maybe this is the reason nothing happened. I heard you saying that we are independent in terms of energy supplies. And we are not dependent on Russia, which is not true. We are still very dependent on that. And it's more than 90% of our imports, both natural gas and oil, comes from Russia. So I find it difficult to accept the explanation. But okay, that just to let you know, it is not that we are independent. We will be one day, and it is going to happen very soon.
The problem is not solved yet.
You are closer, fundamentally closer to energy independence than us. acceptable?
Of course.
Because from May, you will have the Szczecin LNG, and you have the Qatar ships, you have the contracts, and we don't have neither LNG nor Qatar ships, nothing. And that makes a difference. And I think the vulnerability of your society on gas concerning the households is also fundamentally different. In Hungary, 85% of the households is heated by this gas, because in the last 25 years after the transition, we thought it's a good idea to finance and to subsidy the households to turn their energy supply on gas. So I take the point that Central Europe is in general in a different situation, in a difficult situation. And Europe in general is in a difficult situation. We need solidarity with each other. We don't need to accuse each other, but we need to believe and trust our neighbors and our friends that we can, in order to facilitate a situation, that we can rely. And I think that is this positive attitude is basically the most important, because we may have similar situations. It may result in different policies, but if we have an elementary level of trust towards each other, then I think everything is okay.
Okay, so now a question. If we remove the dust from the papers we have, can we get back to work on infrastructural projects connecting Poland and
Hungary? Definitely. I think this is high time to do that. And concerning us, we have nothing to, I mean, the Orban cabinet. I don't take responsibility for the Ukraine. But as far as the Orban cabinet is concerned, we have invested a lot into this project. And I have to tell you, this was not a profit-oriented project. The interconnector with Slovakia, which we built, was an economic loss. But we did it, and that is the same with the Romanian and the Croatian interconnector. And we hope that our partners, the Romanian and the Croat partners, will finally fulfill their obligations to make these pipelines two-way, which is not the case, unfortunately, yet. So I think a major Central European road, railway, gas, energy, infrastructural cooperation should be launched. And I think this is the moment to do that.
Okay, good evening. I'm Irina Pozelova, Center for East European Studies in Warsaw. Getting back to the nationality issue, to the Hungarian national minority in Romania. Currently, the political situation in Hungary is the following. The Jobbik party is getting more and more popularity, so there is a point to think that the population is getting more far right and radicalizing. And the Fidesz is losing its support. So do you think it's a window of opportunity to the Hungarian ethno-political organizations, to the ethno-political organizations of Hungarian minority in Romania to start their quest for cultural autonomy in Romania over again? Because I don't think that Mr. Iohannis can organize, make favorable conditions in Romania right now, because according to the constitution of Romania, it's a unitary state. So do you think that he here, Jobbik, Hungary, there is a solidarity, of course, there's a new amendments to the nationality law in Hungary. So do you think that Jobbik or Fidesz would support the radical quest for autonomy of László Tékes or Hungarian, the Council of Transylvania or Hungarian Democratic Union?
You are a very good expert. I would be interested in your views on the subject, how to do things. But I would like to clarify that that data that Fidesz is losing ground and Jobbik is coming up is 3 months old. Data. So now we are back, and Jobbik is back there, also where they were, and Fidesz is as strong as we were at the last elections. Jobbik is, you are right, trying to. To generate these sentiments, national sentiments, but their prime focus is not Hungarians outside Hungary, and the Hungarian society responds to Jobbik especially because of anti-Roma, anti-EU, anti-Western, anti-anything approaches. And I'm sure you have got this as well, this kind of populism, and there is no really party who would not show similar kind of political signs in Europe. In Hungary, the strength of extremism is not at all over the average, and we don't look at it as a serious problem. I think if Jobbik is there, we can manage it. We are trying to avoid to have a left political rival against us. That is more serious. So the Hungarian community in Transylvania and Romania, they have basically one party which enjoys the 85% of the vote in the Romanian Hungarian community. That is the so-called Hungarian Alliance, of Democratic Alliance in Romania. And they have pretty good chances to enter any government which will come next time. The opposition, two smaller parties which constitute 15% of the popular support, are more outspoken on autonomy and on symbolic issues. And I think this is part of democracy. And in the end, it is not the decision that we make in Budapest counts, but it is the decision what they do and into which direction they move. And as I told in the previous answer, we are trying to strengthen the regional cooperation, and we are trying to create favorable conditions for the satisfaction of the minority communities as well.
Focus is on export, exchange of goods and foreign direct investments. I would like to ask you about the prospects for the development of bilateral cooperation. So you spoke about the values, about the Central Europe, but what are the possibilities with respect to the extension, development of the bilateral cooperation for Polish and
będzie ostatnia seria pytań. To jest ostatnia okazja do zadania pytania, więc jeśli Państwo macie ochotę, to proszę, jak nie, to...
Godziński, Kasatowanko. I have two questions. How fresh is in the Hungarian nation a memory about the Soviet invasion 1956? And what do you, second question is what do you think about 16+1 initiative partnership between Central and Eastern European countries and China?
The economic cooperation. So I believe we don't have the appropriate basic infrastructure. And if we decided to have large-scale infrastructure program, I think that would boost very much the business cooperation between our countries. Obviously, then the entrepreneurs from both countries could play a pivotal role in that. I mentioned the defense industry cooperation. I think that is also a field. If you spend so much money that we increase 2 to 3% our defense budgets, definitely it opens up a huge potential to generate genuine cooperation. Exports, different touristic potential, the homegrown industries, like we are pretty good in certain segments and you are pretty good in certain segments, open up also for trade and service and investment cooperation. It requires, I think, a very thorough attention. Concerning China, the global opening is a policy which is pursued by all of the Central European countries. We have some results. We haven't reached as much as we wanted. The only viable project which in the recent period was born is the Berlin-Budapest railway. That is what China gives a strong accent, and they want to extend it to Thessaloniki. So a Budapest, Belgrade, Thessaloniki railway is going to be built as a consequence of this new China pivot towards Central Europe. There we have a few investors in Hungary from China, but not China is the main country from Asia who is present in the Hungarian market. The strongest presence is from South Korea. They are the most important Asian investor. Recently, we had a very significant investment from China into tires. And especially in the car industry, we experience attention and manufacturing of IT products as well. And in the financial segment, Japan plays a major financing role from East Asia. But other countries, obviously, and now we are not just the Eastern, but the Southern direct dimension enjoys an attention on our side. South America and Africa as well. Your other question, which relates the 56, makes a good framework for our evening today. My parents were actively involved in the revolution. They were fighting in the revolution. And we are a generation, Fidesz is a generation who is coming from this opposition, revolutionary, difficult to define barely what is still characteristic that we don't have too many so-called Communist Party members in our social compromise orchestrated by the communists, the so-called Gulag communism, which made a fundamentally different, resulted in a fundamentally different situation. And Kádár, by the end of the 80s, became very popular in Hungary. And that could be the basis for this pendulum, this political pendulum we have experienced in the last 25 years. So a big difference is that 56 was 60 years ago, while your memory is more fresh, and probably even the other Central European countries, especially if we look to Lithuania, who were fighting for their freedom in 91, that is even more fresh. So I think we need to do our utmost to have a memory policy and to list, we have named quite a few potential fields of cooperation between Poland and Hungary, between Fidesz and PiS. I think this is definitely one field in which we should take seriously the cooperation in the so-called memory policy. And it is a very broad category, but I think if we want to maintain the character of our nations, of our societies, we have to do it. And there are broad possibilities in this regard. I don't want to go into that. But for example, in Hungary, we have introduced the Day of the Victims of Communism. Also, we have introduced the Day of the Victims of the Holocaust. The above mentioned House of Terror. The support which we have given to the European Platform for Memory and Conscience, which is a Prague-based institution, or the Victims of Communism Foundation in Washington, D.C., or the Canadian initiative which wants to erect a statue for the victims of communism in Ottawa. So I believe that this is a prime field for future Polish-Hungarian cooperation. Thank you very much for coming, for your attention.
Dziękuję bardzo. Dziękuję Państwu za spotkanie i oczywiście dziękuję za przybycie.